Good afternoon. Good morning here, but so I'm Simon Krenes. I live in Washington, D.C. Very briefly about me, I did a PhD in automated reasoning on topics connected to superposition, mostly superposition with arithmetic, automated induction, and other things. Currently, I worked at Imandra. We are doing source verification for the financial sector in OCaml. I'm a long-time OCaml programmer, which is how I know Dimitri. If at any point you have questions, please ask. Please interrupt me. So today we're going to talk. We're going to get an overview of the superposition calculus relatively in depth. I haven't talked about this in a little while. So I'll give some pointers and references to papers and books. If you really want to dig into the theory after that, if I didn't push you away from the superposition world. So as a very brief overview of what we're going to talk about, superposition is a refutational proof system. So you have a conjecture, you have a formula you want to prove in first order logic. You call a prover and it's going to try to prove it by refutation, by trying to derive false from the negation of this formula. So I'm going to go over all of this in succession. So first, quick recap of first order logic, then see the inference rules of superposition, some absolutely critical refinements around the term ordering. It's not just an inference system, it's an inference system with constraints, and these make it work in practice. I will touch on saturation and briefly sketch the completeness argument. There's no real formulas, it's just try to give an overview. I will then talk about simplification rules. I will briefly talk about theories, how to integrate theories like arithmetic into superposition, and then just give a few more references. Okay, so far so good. So let's dive into the basics of superposition for a start. So let's see classical first order logic. So really, it's the millennia old formalism where you have predicates, you have quantifiers and variables. So in this case, you have a for all x. If x is a cat, then x is cute. That's a kind of core axiom. And this is a basic syllogism based on that. So just notation briefly, we have conjunction A and B, we have disjunction A or B, implication, which in classical logic is just the same as A plus B is just not A or B. And we're going to rely on this a lot because superposition is clausal. It relies on clauses, which are disjunctions of atoms without negation. You have for all, you have exist, and negation. And again, negation is involutive. So it's really not the same as type theory. We exploit a lot the fact that this is classical logic. Any question on this one? No? Okay. So the second thing is we don't want to just talk about first order logic, but we want to talk about equational first order logic, which technically is just an extension. You could axiomatize it, but in practice, you want equality to be absolutely at the center of everything. It's very hard to write problems without any equality. So we have a predicate for equations. And basically, you have the Leibniz principle that you can replace equals by equals in other terms. And this is to be distinguished from the kind of straight equal, which we just use to denote syntactic equality of terms. So superposition, which was introduced in the 90s, is the proof system for this particular logic, and it begs equations at its core. So it's state of the art. If you look at the first order prover competitions, all the good provers are superposition based. Especially if you have equations, it's just by far the best. SMT solvers are getting good, but they're not exactly good at the same things, and I will say that more about that later. There's been recent efforts by colleagues and friends of mine, and myself actually, to go up a bit higher and go into higher order logic, classical higher order logic, so where you have lambdas, lambda functions. Yes?
Sorry, what's the origin of the term superposition? Why is it called like this?
Oh, well, I have absolutely no idea why. Really, you superpose terms. I mean, honestly, I don't even think the handbook brushes on that. It's pretty evocative, I think.
Okay. Right.
It's a good question. I'm really not versed into the history of it. Like, it stems from paramodulation, but no idea. So historically, it's been for a long time about untyped first order logic, but more recently, people have used more and more typed first order logic, and these days, it's as per last year, really, higher order type logic. Whoops. Focus. So let's give just a very quick example of a proof in it. So in this case, first notation. So this is a derivation. The fraction bars means from what is above, you can deduce what is below. So the first upper left part is Felix is a cat, is a chat in French, and chat and cat are the same thing, so they're equal. So you can substitute chat with cat, and you get the blue box, which is a new literal, a new formula, which says that Felix is a cat. And then you have the other axiom that we've seen before, that all cats are cute. It's expressed not as an implication, but as a clause, so the quantification is implicit, and it's a disjunction. And then we can use the resolution rule, which really is much older, it's from the 60s, to deduce that Felix is cute. So this is extremely basic, but we can already see the basics of equational reasoning, replacing equals by equals. And first order reasoning, we have a variable that is substituted with a term. So in particular, we find that X and Felix are to be bound together by unification. A unification is like a diff algorithm. You have two different terms, two different expressions, and you're going to really run a diff on them and try to patch the diff by binding variables. Like if you have on one side X, on the other side a term, you can bind X. But if you have distinct terms, you cannot do anything. It's incompatible. In practice, you don't need resolution. Here it was just simpler to show one thing at a time.
And so, may I clarify?
Yes.
Do we use implicit quantification in such formulas like in horn clauses?
Yes, absolutely. The clauses are not horn. They can be arbitrary. They can have several positive literals, but it is definitely implicit. And that's because we are classical logic. Classical logic, you can get every formula into clauses, like the one on the right, with a variable. It is for all x, the disjunction. Variables are always implicitly quantified, universally.
Yeah. Then what encoding is used for existence quantification, existential quantification?
Yes. Typically, people just schemize your formula, so you assume the choice function. And the exist becomes a scalem function.
Yeah, right. Thanks.
Sure. So this exist problem could be expressed with a scalem. a very simple problem that I can just like show you that you can actually prove this kind of stuff. So this is a bit of a textbook example of what superposition is good at, meaning algebra, lot of equations, lots of variables, not necessarily easy for people to grasp, because, you know, it's just a soup of symbols sometimes. So in this case, we have a very simple problem that I wrote in this format. You can see that, right? So just a few axioms, a few notations, and I can run the proposition on it, and I get the proposition, which is a prover that I worked on during my PhD. I get a refutation, which you should not look at because it's just a series of inference steps. But you can get this particular view out of it. So like you start with a goal and then you take its negation, schemize it, so turn the not for all into, oh, actually that is schemization here, because you have a not for all, which becomes an arcless logic exist not. So it's not exist not, exist A and B, where A and B, A times B is E, but B times A is not E. So you get scolems, and after a bunch of inferences that we're not going to look into because they're just, I mean, it's not very relevant actually, you get a bunch of clauses, and then you get the empty clause, which means false, which means the initial problem was a theorem. So this is like a very easy problem in this case, but if you start this, if you try this in a tableau prover, for example, which are typically based on sequence calculus, it's already pretty hard because of all the equational reasoning. Okay. So any question on that particular side, or maybe if you want to see the proof in more details, I will send the slides later. No? Okay. So, yeah. A bit more about the substitutions. Briefly, we have substitutions that we typically write sigma, so sometimes rho. These map variables to terms. So first order variables map to first order terms, which can also contain variables. And everything is centered around unification, just like in resolution, or like if you do datalog or prolog. Prolog is based on the exact same unification algorithm. It just has a very different search algorithm. But everything relies on, like, all the substitutions are found by unification. They're not random guesses. They are found by matching terms together, well, unifying terms. So in particular, here you can see that X and Felix can be bound because they are the same position and X is not bound already. Similarly for these terms with F and A and Y. Sometimes unification can fail because of various criteria, like you can't make a cyclic substitution, you can't match terms that have different function symbols. But really, this is the first order part is all centered on unification. All right, so let's get a bit into the rules. This is going to be a bit dense. I don't necessarily need to understand everything, but I want to at least cover that. So there's going to be this symbol, suxec, or kind of greater or equal ish, right? That is a term ordering. I will talk a lot more about this in the next section. Here it just appears in like guards or site conditions. And otherwise, sigma is a substitution. We have clauses C and D. We have notation to replace a subterm of a term. Like if you have a term U, you can put different term at a position inside. You can substitute the term inside. And I'm going to totally omit some conditions because they are useful, but just really out of scope. Okay, so the first rule is called equality resolution. And really, if you have a clause where you have a clause C or a literal S not equal T, if you can make it so that S and T are the same term by unification, like if you find sigma that makes S and T the same, then after substituting, you can get the exact, you can just remove the literal because they are, because you get basically S sigma different than S sigma, which is absurd. So you can just remove it. So this is used a lot to like to simplify clauses, to remove one literal. You can also use it for Boolean reasoning. If you prove typically true is not equal to true, you can just remove that. So this one is pretty simple because it just goes smaller. You can just get smaller clauses. It's cheap, it's easy. Now we can see the, this is kind of the scariest slide, okay? The superposition rule, which is really the workhorse of a prover, a lot of the work is going to be spent in this particular rule. So we've seen an example earlier of that, which I'm going to show briefly. So here, the first one is an instance of that. You have a clause on the left, you have an equation on the right, and you're going to replace a subterm with another subterm. So basically, the terms in red are unified against one another. So on the left, you have the active clause, which is S equal T, or some context C, like the context is just kept around. It's like a sequence, you can just carry it over. But you're going to try to rewrite S into T in a subterm of the other clause. So you're going to match S against S2. And in the conclusion, you replace S with T at the position where S2 was. So one way of seeing that, of looking at that, is to consider that as conditional rewriting. We're going to rewrite S into T, assuming C is false. And in particular, in the case where C is all negative, it's rewriting with an on clause, so it's just like a conditional rewrite rule. And of course, there's a sigma involved because typically S and S2 are not the same term, but they can be unified. So you might have to perform some substitutions to replace S with T. And oh yeah, and equal question mark is just, it's either equal or distinct. You just keep the right literal. And you have constraints about orderings, as I was promising. When you write S into T, S must not be smaller than T. You kind of go downhill in some sense. Or at least you don't go uphill. I will explain more about that later. But these conditions are extremely important. And if you don't use that, you won't prove anything interesting. It's just going to, the search space is going to explode instantly. Because this can rewrite a lot of things in many places. So I know this is a bit dense. Do you have questions about that one, or are you just stunned?
I have a question.
Yes.
Actually, I'm a little bit confused by this equality. I presume it's a sort of semantic equality, not a syntactic one. And
yes.
The previous rule, can you switch to the previous rule? Yeah. So doesn't it involve somehow a unification model equational theory? Because you need to ensure that these terms are not equal in order to apply unification.
So you could have unification modulo theories. In theory, it's possible. In practice, not many people do it. It's just very complicated.
Yeah, right. That's why I'm asking this question, because in the premise you have this relation that S is not semantically equivalent to T. How can you establish this fact? In order to apply this rule, you need to establish the fact that the premise is true. So,
oh, sorry.
This was what kind of confuses me.
Okay, sorry. So I'm going to explain this one in more details. So
okay.
That is, this is an inference rule. So you assume that the formula, the clause above is true. It can be an input axiom. It can be something you derived earlier. But it's not, I mean, it's a formula of your problem. It is not some meta-level statement. Like, you're going to start from the input clauses, and you're going to apply the rules in a fixed point, which is saturation. I will explain that later. But really, you assume the clause above is true, and it contains a negative literal. So all you're going to do is you can eliminate the negative literal when it's absurd. Namely, when you can make the terms syntactically equal, you know that they are necessarily equal in general. So you can just deduce that it's not possible that S and T are distinct because they are syntactically equal. So you have to shrink the clause to the remainder to C under sigma. It's a bit like, I mean, literally, this is a resolution with the reflexivity axiom, which hence the name. You have an axiom x equals x, and you do resolution with x equals x by unifying s and t with x in both cases, in prolog terms, if you want.
Okay, thank you.
So it comes from the fact that the syntactic equality is stronger than the
yes.
Semantic.
Yeah, indeed. If two terms are syntactically equal, then they are always semantically equal because semantic equality is reflexive. So always S equals S, yes. So the side condition here indeed tells us if we can make them syntactically equal by unification, then we can assess that the S distinct than T is absurd. And we can just remove it. And
I also had a question for the next slide. Would you describe it in more detail later, whether both conditions on inequalities, the last conditions you described, are necessary?
So I will talk a lot more about these. So if you remove these conditions, the rule is still sound. It will still deduce valid things. It's still correct, but it's just unusable. It's just a bad calculus if you remove these conditions. As in, the prover will not, even the problem I showed earlier, the demo, which was instant, if you remove these conditions, it becomes not very trivial. And the bigger the problem, the faster it will explode. So these are extremely important in practice. And they also play a role in the completeness argument, as we will see later. So typically you want S to be bigger than T and U to be bigger than V, but in general you kind of approximate. You do a little bit more than needed because there are limits to what can be efficiently computed. So anyway, again, I will talk more about the orderings later. The third one, let's just not get into it. It's there just for completeness. It is weird. It is rarely useful, as in a typical proof, it might occur just a few times or even not at all. You just need it if you want the proof to be complete. It's a bit unintuitive. So these make the superposition calculus, and on paper, they're complete. In practice, a prover will do a lot more than that. You will have many more rules that are there for efficiency and to kind of curb the search space. server device. So we talk about simple fiction rules. You can also keep resolution. It's not strictly necessary, but like Vampire does it because I think they optimize the resolution super heavily. And it can be a bit simpler when you don't have equations.
Sorry, do you mean those are admissible rules or they are new to the system, like fundamentally?
So the three previous rules are complete. These rules, the rules that you add, they are admissible. They will not deduce anything that new.
I see.
Typically, they will rather actually, they will help you remove clauses.
Okay, thank you.
A few references that personally I like, but really non-exhaustive. If you just want one paper on superposition, I would really, really recommend the eProver paper from, I think it was 11 or 13, from Stefan Schultz. It's on the prover E, which is one of the top superposition provers. It's an overview. It's really, really good. I mean, it covers the rules, inference, simplifications, the main loop. It at least mentions topics like indexing. I've opened this paper in my PDF viewers so many times. And the other one for a more thorough theoretical reference would be the Handbook of Automated Reasoning. The paperback version is a bit big and costly, but you can find online references of the chapter on paramodulation, which has a lot of explanations about the theoretical arguments. I think there are more recent explanations as well by Waldman. But this is a pretty good theoretical overview. All right, let's get into the more exciting stuff. So term orderings, the two next sections are really about things that makes superposition work in practice, because the rules are not particularly special. What makes them special is the ordering and the redundancy. I mean, that's what makes the prover work in practice. So the main idea really is we are going to, superposition is kind of rewriting. It's conditional, but you still are rewriting a term into another using an equality. And the main idea is if you rewrite in one way, you don't want to rewrite in the other way, because then you do twice as much work and you undo your previous work. And it's a total mess. So the whole idea is, as much as possible, we're going to use an ordering. We're going to say if A is bigger than B in some sort of total ordering, or ideally total, then you write in this direction. You only go towards smaller terms. So when you have ground terms, when the terms don't have any variables, typically the ordering is total. So you can have perfect inferences, and you even know that prover is going to terminate. In a pure SND setting, some people have worked on using superposition as an SND solver, where you just have ground clauses, you don't have variables, and then you know that it's a decision procedure. You know that things are going to terminate. You're going to saturate every time. Well, it might take a long time, but you're going to saturate. Or find false. Of course, on first order logic, you have variables. So then you don't have this property that terms are totally ordered. But you want to cover, you can still order a lot of terms, and you want to make sure that you will write if there's at least one instance that goes decreasing. So you write A into B. If there is at least one sigma where A sigma is bigger than B sigma, because you want to cover all the ground inference rules, all the ground inferences. So that's really the core of the term ordering. It is there to just go decreasing when you rewrite. There's also more restrictions. You don't have to do that on every term of a clause. You can just consider the biggest ones for some notion of bigger. And together, these two things make it so that the search space, the inferences you can do at a given point, there's a lot fewer than if you didn't have any ordering. And again, you have termination, and it is going to be sent the center of the completeness argument. So, okay, supervision is complete, as in, well, it's technically it's semi-complete because the problem is undecidable, well, it's semi-decidable. So by this, I mean, if you give supervision a formula that is true, a theorem, if you give the negation of this formula to the prover, it will eventually find false. It will eventually deduce false and therefore prove your theorem. Eventually makes a lot of work there because it can be in 10 billion years, but on paper it's going to find it at some point. If it's not a theorem, it might diverge, it might just run forever or not. Sometimes it terminates. So the idea here, and again, this is in the handbook of automated reasoning. So you have your term ordering, which is well-behaved, it has a lot of properties. You extend it to literals, which are like these sign formulas, and then to clauses. So you can compare clauses, not just terms. Then you assume you have a saturated set. I will explain more about that later, but anyway, you assume that you didn't find false. So the idea is, if you didn't find false, you're going to show that you have a model, and therefore that the thing is satisfiable. So to do that, you have your closed set. The model is going to be a set of rewrite rules, which all go downhill again. All these rules are going to be decreasing in the order. So you cannot talk about completeness without the ordering. It's impossible. And then you're going to sort the clauses by increasing fashion, and you're going to consider the ground clauses. So the completeness argument doesn't touch variables at all. Well, I mean, you have to lift it at some point, but the basic argument considers ground clauses, no variables. And it's going to you're going to consider them one by one, going from the smallest one to the biggest one. And that typically there should be countably infinitely many of them. But it's countable, so we are good. And so you're going to consider clauses in ascending order by this ordering. And then for each of the clauses, if it's satisfied by the model, you're good. And you just continue to the next clause. Otherwise, it's going to, not going into details, but it's going to add a rewrite rule to your problem, to your model, which makes it true. And otherwise, you can show that it's that the other case is impossible because you would have found a way of finding a smaller clause that is not satisfied. So the argument is kind of pretty when you, I mean, I encourage you to look at actual papers, but really the inference rules are such that you just can rule out this third case by saying, oh yeah, the clause can contribute a rule, but look, it has this shape, so it means you could have done this inference. So anyway, what I want to say about this is really the ordering is used in both to build a model as decreasing rules, decreasing equations, and to build the model from clauses in increasing order. And really, I mean, I'm expecting you to understand exactly all the details. But it's still part of the, it's why the ordering is so important. So in practice, you have a bunch of orderings that are used in most provers. So KBO is the biggest one, Knuth-Bendix ordering. It's from infinite completion. So Knuth and Bendix had something before superposition that was not as good because it was sometimes failing. It could fail to saturate. It could fail to build a confluent set. But with the ordering, it's all good. And this ordering is pretty good. It's like Vampire is going to use that first, typically. It tends to make time small. It's fast to compute. And there's RPO. So you might have some interesting ordering. So in termination, typically they would consider rewrite systems. Again, a set of rewrite rules from left to right. And I try to find an ordering that makes all the rules go from left to right as well, and to make it a well-founded ordering to show that these rules terminate. And to do that, they're very complicated constructions. So anyway, you can have orderings that are compatible with things like associativity and commutativity. And this was used in the famous proof in the 90s, I think. A very hard algebra problem that was solved by a theorem prover that was built on superposition after running it for like a month. And it was all done modulo AC because it's just like a kind of weird group theory kind of problem. And last thing about term ordering is it's a very important heuristic. So you have many choices in what term ordering you can use in a prover, and this is going to impact significantly the proof search. A proof might be very easy with one ordering and very hard with another one. And this is a quote from the E paper, where it's kind of, he has good heuristics, but this is maybe the weakest point, just because there's a lot of choice. Okay. Do you have any questions about orderings in general? No? All right. The second thing is redundancy criterion. So ordering is kind of...
Simon, wait.
Yes.
I think a few slides ago you discussed the question I asked you in email, why the saturated set is not infinite, or it was something else. I really didn't understand well a few slides ago.
In this one?
Yeah. There is you tried to explain why the saturated set is finite. By explaining algorithm how we enrich this set, and I didn't understand why it is still finite. Can you repeat this?
In this particular one, it's all infinite, actually. I mean, this is a theoretical construction. The model is built on the ground clauses, and you generally have infinitely many of them. So really, this is more of an induction argument, where you're saying, if the closed set is saturated, well, if the ground set is saturated. Sorry. If you have a closed set that is saturated, whether it's finite or not, the set of its ground instances, so all the instances of the closes, where you replace variables with any possible term that fits, which this is probably going to be infinite. And this is what you build the completeness argument on. So you're going to go, when I say for each clause, it's for each ground clause in a countably infinite set. So this is not going to give you a model you can write on paper. All you have is a way of, you write an induction proof to say, okay, in theory, I could build this model. But it's not what Ruva is going to give you in practice, if it gives you anything.
But does not the superposition, how to say, solver, does not it build the saturated set actually in practice?
So it can give you, sometimes it can give you a saturated set, but it's not going to be a model. It's going to be something that you, on paper, could build a model from, if you could write an infinite model on paper. I was going to eat later, but I have a small demo of saturated set. So this is a problem I transcribed badly a while ago. So it's very simple first order logic problem that turns out to be satisfiable. And if you just run it, if you just run superposition on it, blah blah blah, it has some input clauses, it does a bunch of steps of I will talk about the main loop, but there's some new inferences, new inference. At some point it's going to tell us saturate, and here is a set of final clauses. So all this stuff is like metadata. It's kind of junk. It's just metadata for debugging. But here you can see that, for example, there's this particular clause, taking of x or not f of g of x, which is first order. So you get a bunch of clauses, but this is not a model. You don't have a good way of building a model out of that. The model exists as a theoretical construction, but it's not straightforward or even doable to write it in a finite way. It's just like you can show that there's, you can build the real numbers from Dedekind cuts or Cauchy sequences, but you cannot write the sequence by hand. You can just show on paper that it exists. You can talk about it abstractly, but you cannot write it down. Or like the digits of pi, you cannot write them down. You just can describe a way of computing them. And similarly here, I can tell you that there's a way, given the ordering that the prover chose, that way of building a model from that. But it is not straightforward because in this particular clause, for example, which if it's not satisfied, sometimes you might pick the left literal and sometimes you might pick the right literal, depending on the particular instance. I don't know. Other to say, you can saturate and still not get a model that is usable. I'll talk more about saturation though. This is really to explain that the term ordering gives you a theoretical construct for completeness based on building a model, but the model is not finitely representable. Does it make sense? Okay. Okay, so I'm going to talk about saturation in this particular part. So for a start, there's the notion of redundancy, which helps us. So inference rules are there to make new clauses, typically because we hope to deduce false at some point. We hope to deduce false from other things and prove that it was a theorem in the first place. But because we create a lot of new clauses during the search, it helps to be able to remove clauses when they are, well, redundant. So typically, a clause is redundant with respect to other clauses if it's implied by the other clauses and it's bigger. So of course, actually double bar in this case. Yay. So if the smaller clause of the set imply the clause. So typically, it means that this clause, first, it's big, which means it comes later in the proof. And second, it doesn't bring you any new knowledge. So you can just like throw it away. A particularly important example of this, which also works in resolution, is subsumption. So even if you do data log or prolog with tabling, you might meet this particular thing where you can kind of reuse, you can dismiss a clause if you already have a more general one at hand. So in this particular case, you have a clause D that is a superset of a subset of an instance of C. So if C subsumes D, you can just throw away D and you lose nothing. You lose nothing of value. You just have one fewer clause, which means your search space is going to be smaller because you don't have to generate new things from D. And this is, again, in practice, this is absolutely critical. And something that doesn't really have a pendant on SMT, as far as I know. You just, because it's not based on saturation anyway. But redundancy makes it possible to not explode too fast. Some provers like Vampire even throw away clauses that are not really redundant because they know that within the time they have, they will not use these clauses anyway. But this is, at least this is complete. This is completeness preserving. So Dimitri, this is like for the saturation process. This is what saturation means. It's more of an operational view of the proof. Like we've seen how to deduce clauses from other clauses. But this is a bit more on how it's actually done in practice. Or how you can do that as a process. So it's a process that you have a series of sets of clauses. The first set is your input problem. And at some point, and then you have a loop. At every step, you can add an inferred clause. Say you have two clauses in SI and they superpose. You get a new one and you can add it to the set. Or you can remove a redundant clause that belongs to the set, but it's redundant, which means you don't need it. And so you can shrink the set. And at some point, you might find false, which means you have won. I mean, the problem was a theorem. But otherwise, it is possible that you get a set that is kind of a fixed point because you cannot add anything to it that is not redundant. If all the new inferences are already kind of covered by the set, it's said to be saturated up to redundancy. And this is why you can get a fixed point. You can get you can terminate even though you have rules that add new clauses, because you stop if you don't have any new interesting clause, as in non-redundant. And you can just return sat, say that problem was a counter satisfiable. But it doesn't mean you have a model, because the model is just this theoretical construct that you could do on the ground instances of your set. And no one's going to build all the ground instances of the set. It's just infinite. And it is possible that you never reach saturation. It's possible that you're just going to add and add and add to the set and never finish, never terminate. There's also a notion of fairness. You cannot delay an inference forever, but it doesn't really matter here. So earlier, when I was demoing briefly the this is exactly what happens here, basically. You infer new clauses, but they're redundant, so you drop them, So at some point, you don't have any new clause to process. Like you even pick a clause and it's actually redundant. So we reach a point where you don't have anything new to say, and therefore, you know, the thing is counter-satisfiable. Are there questions on that one?
Sorry, I might have missed that, but how does the tool, or the logic, understand that a clause is redundant?
Ah, so, of course, I mean, sorry, that's a good question. This is the formal definition. C is redundant if it's implied by the smaller clauses, but that's undecidable, so you cannot have a perfect criterion for that. In practice, all you have are a set, like you have a collection of rules that you know that tells you, that tell you, oh, okay, this clause is actually redundant and I can compute it. And the more of these rules you have, the better, because you're going to be able to remove more clauses. In practice, it can be very costly as well, like subsumption. Subsumption, it's very powerful because you can remove a clause if it's, well, you know, you can compare two clauses and say, okay, the first one does subsume the second one, but it's already kind of costly to compute. And generally, you want to do it on every pair of clauses you have. And so a lot of the effort in writing an actual prover go into indexing. Indexing kind of is like a filter. It's like instead of doing a search in an array, you have a hash map. And you have the same kind of things for subsumption and unification. And Vampire, to name it again, Vampire is very strong implementation-wise, because they spent a lot of time implementing all sorts of crazy algorithms and crazy indexes to do these kind of checks super fast. So Vampire is going to do a lot more redundancy checks than, say, E.
Thank you. It makes a lot of sense now.
Yeah, I also say simplifications because you have rules which are very similar to, typically to superposition, but they're not inferences in the sense that they're like, instead of finding a new clause, you can replace the old clause. You can take, like you have a clause that rewrites and a clause that is rewritten. And in some cases, you can remove the clause that was rewritten because you can show that the conclusion subsumes it. In which case, basically, it's very nice because you don't add new clauses, you just change one. And it's smaller because you only go downhill. And this is also very important. All right, we're almost done with the core of really all the explanations. So in practice, actually, the abstract saturation process, which people use also for completeness proofs. In practice, in terms of code, you have this quasi-universal algorithm called given clause algorithm, where typically you have two sets. You have a set of processed and a set of unprocessed clauses. And you're going to keep the invariant that the processed set is, you have done all the possible inferences within it. So it starts empty. And unprocessed is just your input problem. And while you have a clause to process, you pick one. So the given clause comes from that, right? It's during one iteration of the loop, you have one given clause that you're going to move from unprocessed to processed. But actually, if it's redundant, you don't even have to do anything. And that's what happens in the demo earlier. We picked a clause, and actually it turned out that it was redundant. So we just drop it and go to the next loop iteration. But otherwise, you do the other, you filter in the process clause, you filter the clauses that are made redundant by this one, just backward subsumption. It also helps keep the sets small. Then you do all the new inferences. This is a new set. Then you filter them. Again, you don't want to keep clauses that are redundant. And this is just one version. You can make a lot of variations on this one. You could check the clauses C against unprocessed as well, if you have a lot of time to spend on this. As long as you can compute it, you know, it's allowed. But this is the like, cheaper version. Well, just check if the new clauses, you filter the new clauses for not redundant. You put them in unprocessed for later iterations, and C moves to processed. So process grows at most one clause at a time. Sometimes you can shrink it because you found a really nice small clause that is going to remove a lot of old stuff. And this is like this is described in the paper about E. And really, it's the main loop. It's, again, in this particular thing. Oh, yeah, the colors are bad. This is like step 41 of the loop, step 42 of the loop. It picks a given clause. It picks given clauses, but they are just redundant. So it drops them before it does anything. Infers new clauses, but they're probably filtered anyway. This is what saturation looks like in practice. You stop. I should have put exit conditions in there, sorry. More patching, I guess. So when you pick the next clause, if it's empty, you win, right? And otherwise, if the loop finishes without anything left to process, then you have reached saturation. Or you might just loop forever, it depends. Okay, so that was the most, that was really the core of the talk. I'm going to expand a bit on theories and applications. So one of the big applications currently for superposition provers are hammers, so-called hammers. So they're like the big red button that you push when you are tired and you want the, you are in a proof system like Isabel Hall. You have a lemma to prove, you're tired, you push the sledgehammer button and you hope it's going to solve the goal for you. It might not. You might get lucky or not. There are similar systems for actual light. I think there's one for Coq these days. They work for Lean. Similarly, in verification tools like Y3, it's system is more like essence solvers, but it can call the classic superposition provers as well. I want to say something. These provers are quite impressive, but one of the problems I think is that they're a bit unpredictable. They're very sensitive to the input. If you change a bit the input, they might go from succeeds quickly to doesn't finish in 30 minutes. Or conversely, sometimes you nudge a bit problem and it starts working. But this is true of most of the semi-decidable systems anyway. For essence solvers, it's the same when you have triggers. You change a quantifier trigger and everything collapses. So it comes with the territory, I think. Quick version of the theories. So historically, theories have not been a strong suit of superposition because it is so, it's such an integrated calculus. Everything kind of fits together. So when you want to add kind of foreign objects like integers in it, it's a bit complicated. But I did some research. I think personally for arithmetic being a big deal, I think the clean solution is hierarchic superposition. There was some theoretical work, and more recently, well, in 1415, there was this experimental prover called Beagle that was based on a refined version of hierarchic superposition. So basically, you kind of interact with, you kind of interface superposition with a quantifier elimination procedure that, and the combination is relatively nice. So I think likely to work well if someone was to do it in a bigger prover, in a more production ready prover. Data types and co-data types. There's been recent work in Vampire by Simon Robillard, Jason Blanchette, and someone else, I think. These typically work relatively well because they're already very syntactic, very algebraic, I would say. Induction is a tough nut, but you can do things in practice. It is a very, I mean, you directly jump to totally undecidable, not just semi-decidable. The theory of arrays, as in SMT solving, where you have a get and set, it can be just a set of axioms in superposition. There's some work by Bonacina and colleagues about doing that with E. Deductor, I have no idea. I think all you can hope for is to interface with a Z3 or CBC4 and pray. Although you might have good simplifications, like the algebraic reasoning is good, but the actual solving and going to SAT, the gap is wide, really. And then there's higher order. So again, it's work by colleagues and some papers I also contributed to. It's getting much better. So there was a renewed interest in higher order recently, and we're getting to the point where the superposition is the best higher order technique after a long time where it was not. So that's very exciting. Although higher order is very hard also. Search space is crazy. Overall, I would say there are promising research path, but currently I think Vampire can interface with Z3, but it's very, Z3 does the theory reasoning mostly, and Vampire does the quantifier work. Hopefully, hierarchic superposition becomes more widespread, at least that's what I think would be nice. Yes, a few pointers. Well, honestly, I will just send the slides and you can click on links. It will be simpler. Well, it's an implementation because I like implementation. So it's a lot of work, as it turns out. It's you have like three rules, but in practice, you have a lot more rules, and you have data structures, you have the terms, unification, indexing. A lot of time has to be spent on optimizing the thing and finding completeness bugs, which are terrible. There is no single bottleneck. Everything is a bottleneck. And when you have removed all the bottlenecks, the one that remains is simplifications. Rewriting is where most of the time is spent. The actually good provers are E, Vampire, Spass, although it's a bit unmaintained these days, I think. There's a more experimental one in OCaml that I wrote. I wrote the initial version anyway. There's pretty good slides on how it works for E that I would also recommend not to do your own, but to see a bit how it's done. E is written in C, Vampire is in C++. So it's also decades of work.
Sorry, quick question. So about the choice of the implementation language. So usually see that provers are implemented in a lower level languages, right? Like just you mentioned C and C++. Did you notice heavy performance hit with OCaml, for example?
Some, I guess. Well, first, I didn't spend as much time. Honestly, I picked OCaml because it's still reasonably fast, and it gave me a lot more it bought me time to try new things.
I see.
It's faster to iterate. It's decent. You can get decent performance. But typically, if you look at E, the implementation of terms is very optimized. Other indices, it's kind of as a data structure that kind of you have to allocate more. It's a bit hard to avoid. Honestly, I would say if you write a new prover today, Rust would be a good choice. But C and C++ are very, I mean, they make a lot of sense historically. And they're fast. Vampire is very, very fast. Because, among other things, Vampire was started by Andrei Voronkov, and he wanted it to be fast. And he did a lot of research on term indices. So indices are, again, these kind of that structures that are a bit like the hash map for terms in some sense. You put a lot of terms in it or clauses, and you can query the index for unification or subsumption. You can have like 10,000 clauses and say, I want to find the clauses that are subsumed by this clause. And it will not iterate through the 10,000, it will be faster than that. But both are a lot of work, you know.
Thank you.
So, I mean, basically I'm done. I just wanted to like quickly summarize. The way I see it, at least, superposition is really good at when there's a lot of first order reasoning, and these days higher order, but anyway, when there's a lot of free variables, a bit everywhere. If you have a purely ground problem, just go for SMT, it will be simpler and faster, generally. But when you have variables, the choice is a lot, superposition is very competitive. There's a lot of strong theoretical results about superposition that make it usable. So the time orderings, the redundancy criterion, both are extremely important. And without them, the calculus would just be bad or impractical. And you also have to have a good implementation because even with these refinements, the search space grows quickly. And a naive implementation doesn't cut it. So I think it's good on things that are very algebraic in nature, not particularly semantic, but you know, it's a bit of a poster child, but like group theory, you have a bunch of axioms, equational axioms. This is where superposition is going to be very good, typically. The exciting developments are in higher order these days. Like there's a prover competition, a yearly prover competition. The new entrants are either higher order resolution or higher order superposition. It's pretty cool. As for theories, I would say, I'm not even sure it was a focus of people until maybe last decade at least. And there's a lot of preliminary work, but this is where the bridge between SMT and superposition needs to be, the gap needs to be bridged a bit. And both worlds, I think, need to cooperate. And really, that's all I have to say at this point. So, would you welcome any question?
Thank you.
Can I?
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I've got one remark and one question. So you mentioned one of the applications of this superposition stuff is for hammers, right?
Yes.
So there is cockhammer these days.
Yes.
And while we are this at the Koch theorem prover topic, so do you think would it make sense to integrate them somehow because they're written in the same language, right? Maybe people, from the software development point of view, I mean, purely.
That's a good question. Honestly, I'm not sure. The thing is you have to translate anyway because Koch and superposition have very different structures. Engineer, you want to encode stuff because you want to encode things like equality, which in Coq is not built in. It's, you know, it's weird that type.
Defined.
It's defined as data type. Whereas in superposition, it's such a fundamental thing that, you know, it's, you don't even write the equality, you just have a pair of terms and they are assumed to be equal.
Right.
And I think it makes sense. It's just typically you want a kind of end to M kind of connectivity where you have a kind of intermediate format that several provers could, several proof assistants could target, and this would dispatch to a bunch of provers. This is what Y3 does, but it doesn't do the other direction. It doesn't bring back proofs. So that's.
So in terms of the like proof certificate, right? Like eProver, which produces, is there like any, does the proposition produce this kind of compatible thing? If it does, it could be simple kind of.
So it.
Because Coq, so this Coq Hammer plugin integrates with eProver. So if.
Good to know. I didn't know about that one. Typically, you can.
I see.
You can get this kind of format out.
Uh-huh.
But the problem is, it's so under-specified that you have to have some custom integration. On the part, I think it could be done. It's just the first order world lacks a universally accepted proof format. I think it's a missing break in the system. You get a trace, you don't get something that is easily checkable, which I think is a pity, honestly. At least you get a trace. But you might have to reconstruct each step somehow.
Indeed. Thank you.
More questions? I have actually one. As far as I understand, this theory and this technique is developed for classical case. What about an intergenistic one?
Right. I'm not aware of any work to do superposition for intergenistic logic. Well, okay, for a start, I should say, if you have on clauses, if your problem is on clauses with equations, both classic and intergenistic are the same. So that's straightforward. Basically, the only difference is at the end of the classic case, you will have a absurd because you got T is distinct than T that you resolve into false. But if you just look at this one and you go back one step, it means you just prove that T equals T. So you got a proof. The problem for arbitrary formulas is that you need to schemize. You need to get a clausal form, and that you need to schemize, and both at some point require that you have choice or exclusive middle. So if you have a arbitrary shape formula, I'm not aware of any effort for that. It's automated proving for intuitionistic logic is a very tough problem, and I'm not sure many people work on that, honestly. Because the thing is, with classical logic, it's kind of easier because you always aim for false. And with superposition, it's even easier in some sense because false is the smallest clause. It's smaller than any other clause. So if you always go downward towards smaller clauses, you know you can't go wrong. That's really the intuition I have, honestly. It's go to smaller terms, go to smaller clauses, you might stumble upon false.
Okay, thank you. More questions?
From the SMT perspective, is it right to consider superposition as a procedure for the quantified fragments of the theory of the quality and uninterpreted functions?
So there's been, over the years, there's been some work at the interface between superposition and SMT. There's been several attempts at embedding superposition inside SMT. I would advise to look for Domura and DPLL of Gamma, which is exactly that. It's superposition as a subprover in Z3. I think it might have been a bit disappointing experiment in terms of results, so I'm not sure it's in Z3 anymore. There's also some work by Maria Paula Bonaccina on similar things. But the problem is superposition is not very well behaved as a theory. It's not backtrackable, or it's not easy backtrackable, and it's itself very costly. So I think the interface between SMT and superposition is better served with look for Avatar by Voronkov and colleagues, where you have a kind of, it's more SAT or SMT being embedded inside superposition, or it's more cooperating, and your clauses have one foot in each world.
Oh, thank you. I'm asking because, as I have seen, Vampire actually won the last SMT comp of 2020 in UF track, which is track for quantified.
Oh, wow. Pure UF. That's funny. Okay, well, good for them.
Yeah, the win will not a huge distance from the second solver CVC4, but at least they won.
Yes, and conversely, CVC4 has been entering the first order prover competition for a little while now, and they're pretty good. They're also entering the arithmetic categories where you have quantifiers and arithmetic. So both are kind of, it's good to see a cross-fertilization like that, I think. In some sense, in UF, it's pretty clear that superposition has some sort of an edge because all clauses are equal to its eyes, like whether they're ground or not. It processes them the same way, and it can find new non-ground clauses, like lemmas, shortcuts, where typically SM solvers can only reason on the ground level, or from the ground level, they can instantiate the other clauses to contribute. So yeah, I think it shows that superposition hasn't been made redundant by SMT.
May I ask why the data types theory is, you have pointed out that the recent advances of Voronkov, they investigated data types theory only in at 2018. Isn't it actually straightforward to extend superposition to data types as equality on data types is syntactic equality?
It's easy to get 80% of the way there because equality is easy. You can add a rule for injectivity and for constructor clash, you know, like successor equals nil. You can directly simplify that. The missing piece, and the one that this paper by Robier and colleagues is about, is because you lack one additional criterion, which is acyclicity. The types are acyclic. You have to make sure you find a model where the data types are not cyclic. So they have NRE inferences where you can have multiple clauses in one inference that you chain together to find a cycle well, like the root of the first one is the leaf of the last one, and remove the all these literals because they are together absent. It's like you find a bunch of inequalities in arithmetic where you have A smaller than B, smaller than C, smaller than D, and then at some point smaller than A. Because similarly, arithmetic is, I mean, smaller than is acyclic, right? It's a total ordering. So yeah, acyclicity is where it's difficult. And when you start having quantifiers on top of that, you might directly have to enter the world of induction, inductive theorem proving. Like if you want for all x of type nat for a piano natural number, you start having to do induction. And that's also a lot more difficult than just first order inferences.
And they deal with quantified combination of uninterpreted functions and data types. Is it right?
Yes, although I don't remember what they're complete for. I would say they're probably complete for the ground fragment. And because I'm pretty sure the non-ground fragment requires induction and is therefore totally undecidable.
And when you mentioned induction, does it mean induction only for integers or for any orders or what?
There's a bunch of different papers. There's some work from Pelletier, from what is it, 11 maybe, Kersenian and Pelletier, where it's only on natural numbers. I've done some work on the data type induction. I think vampire people have done some work on induction for well-founded induction. At this point, it's also a lot more engineering and experiment, or like it's a lot more experimental than theoretical because you are in just theoretically hard fragments. I mean, theoretically harder fragments, I would say. I would say it's relatively recent. It's very, very hard, very exclusive because it's not cut admissible typically. So you might have to, for induction, you might have to invent new lemmas out of the blue, which is just impossible in general. So I would say simple inductions can work, but don't expect too much from it.
Thank you. And about straighted sets, the termination actually depends on two bottlenecks on computable function for term ordering and the concept of redundancy, which should also be computable. So do you investigate any properties of termination? Are there any articles? Can you mention any articles which speak about termination of specific criteria or something?
Okay, so even if you have a perfect ordering, like a perfect way of computing the ordering and a very strong redundancy criteria, it might still not terminate first. I want to emphasize that. You have no guarantee it terminates if it's sat, if it's satisfiable. You only have a guarantee it terminates if it's unsat. That being said, there are fragments where you can prove termination, and one of the references I put on there. Oh wait, it's later. Yes, the new results on rewrite-based satiability procedures. Typically, there are four ground sets where you have a bunch of axioms for your theories, including, say, the theory of arrays. And there they can show that the combination of the two terminates, which means that you have a theory for, you have a decision procedure for your theory. In the general case, I'm not sure, honestly. It's very easy to make a prover not terminate.
Thanks. You actually mentioned that that is really hard to somehow reconstruct the to know whether there is a model of a set of input set of clauses. So are there any criteria, maybe theoretic properties of the sets which does have the computable model? So can we somehow know whether the tool will terminate for some, for example, syntactic, some
interesting
horn clauses of some form, for example, for horn clauses with only unary predicates or something? Can we know from the syntactic view of the input horn clauses whether this preposition will terminate? Are there any such criteria?
So, interesting question. I'm not sure. I think, well, for a start, yes, the model, you know that you always know that there's a model, you don't know if it's representable. The question first is, what kind of language do you have to represent your model? Because the only existing language is a set of ground terms, a set of ground equations, but this is generally infinite. So if you don't have that, you need to have something like maybe a set of non-ground but orthogonal rules, because you need to be sure that it's confluent terminating. Otherwise, it's not a model, it's just equations. I mean, the simple answer is, I don't know. The slightly more advanced answer is, I think if you have on clauses with some particular ordering criterions that make the head of the clause always bigger than the body, or if you have selection, I mean, there's also like literal selection systems, but anyway. If you have some kind of stronger stratification of symbols, you might be able to have a model. But honestly, I think it's probably not the best system for that, because it's really not designed to produce models. If you want for some models, you can look into theory evolution, model evolution, I mean. Or like quasi effectively propositional fragment. There's a category at the competition where people have, there's a category for satisfiable problems where the tools produce models. And so they have a kind of, they have a way of talking about the model, at least they're very close to being able to build it. But I'm not aware that any is based on superposition. And even Vampire implements this kind of stuff, but it's just a separate thing. So honestly, I would say that trying to saturate and then extract a model from a saturated set is going to be very hard. And I'm not sure if many people have explored this particular path, because even saturating is not particularly common. Depending on your fragment, it might be, but it's not the expected outcome, I would say.
So what the output of saturation then is for, if it is not easy to
It's mostly for debugging purposes. It's for debugging purposes. If you typically, it means if you have a saturated set, and you are an expert of the prover, you may be able to look at it and see that there's something missing, or like you, that your formula is false for some reason. I mean, the initial formula, not the negated version, that you forgot some kind of hypothesis. It's not meant for machine consumption. And I mean, what I showed was really a debug output. Because typically, completeness bugs are terrible because your system tells you, oh, this is satisfiable after printing 10,000 clauses, and you have to find what inference was missing. It is not fun. I don't know if Vampire even prints a saturated set. Probably if you ask it. But it's you cannot do much with it, honestly.
Thank you. And the last question, as a recap, you have said that you don't know the papers which investigate this very path of whether the saturated set somehow represents the model. Is it right? Or there are any theoretic papers on this?
I mean, I don't know of any theoretic paper. You might, I mean, at this point, it's better to contact someone who is still researching superposition and ask them. But if you look at the way the theoretical model is computed, part of it is really because sometimes you have a first order clause with several literals in the saturated set. And depending on its ground instance, I mean, and you consider all its instances, and for each instance, you might do a different thing. So it's hard to summarize at the first order level. Like you would maybe need a kind of decision tree on ordering of terms, or I don't know. It's very. I don't know how you would represent such a model finitely.
Okay, thank you very much.
Any more questions? If no, then thank you for your very interesting and fresh for us talk and presentation. And thank you very much.
Thank you for the invitation.
Maybe see you some other time. Goodbye, thank you.
All right, bye.